us on our Good Friday service. You know, whether you're here in person or watching us online, we're delighted that you've made the decision to join us for worship today, to worship in the Lord today. My name is Ben, in case you don't know. I'm one of the pastors here. And we'll be starting our service in a few minutes, but just get a few announcements out of the way just to help you enjoy your visit a bit more. In case you need to use the restrooms, just follow the signs out that side door and around the back of the church. There's a cry room just here. It's through that corridor and off to your right. You can see things through that mirror there. There's some kids' activity books at the front desk there if you need to keep little hands busy. And I think that's about it. So let's start our service off with a word from the Psalms. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. Now, that may seem a little bit odd to discuss peace on Good Friday, but peace encompasses a whole lot more than just finding refuge from the storm. In this psalm, we encounter a deeper form of peace, one that can only be attained through a good conscience in the presence of God. It's the peace that can come from good conscience. It's the peace of justification, one that was won on the cross for us when Jesus took our sin upon himself and suffered the penalty of our transgressions. And this is the peace that we celebrate on Good Friday today. So I'm going to ask you all to stand now. We're going to sing two hymns, one after the other. There won't be a break between them. So please stand. If you need to sit down sometime through that, feel free to do so. Let's stand as we begin our service with these hymns. you. Please be seated. Well, we don't have very many announcements today. Just an invitation to join us for Easter Sunday. We're having two services, the 9 o'clock service, which is a bit more traditional, and the 10:30 service, which is a bit more contemporary. And also, feel free to join us any other Sunday of the week too. We have any Sunday of the month, of the year. We have these are our service times, 9 and 10:30. I think that's about it. So I'll invite Damon up, and he's going to pray for us.
Thanks, Ben. Please join me as we come to our Lord in prayer on this Good Friday. A gracious Heavenly Father, we remember today the pain and suffering of the cross, of all that Jesus was willing to endure so that we could be set free. Father, not just the physical pain, but Jesus, our Lord, taking upon himself the full wrath and judgment of God. Father, what love that he would pay the price for sinners like us. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for his sacrifice to offer us the gift of eternal life that we remember on this Good Friday. Our Heavenly Father, we are sinful people. We know that Jesus died because of our sin, because we've lived lives that rejected you. We've lived lives our way instead of your way. Father, please help us never to take Jesus' death for us for granted. Help us to be reminded always of the cost and always reminded of the grace that you've shown us through him. Father, forgive us for being too busy or distracted by the pressures of life. Forgive us for not fully recognizing what you've freely given us. Forgive us for not trusting you and for not living in light of the cross in all of our lives. Thank you, Lord, that by Jesus' wounds we are healed. Thank you that because of his sacrifice we're set free, free from sin and death, and now confident of eternal life. Thank you that sin and death have been conquered, that there's no longer any sting or power in death for those who put their faith in Jesus, for us as we put our trust in him. Father, thank you for raising him from the dead, as we will remember again on Sunday. Raising him as Lord and King over all, raising him as ruler and judge. Please help us to live our lives under him, imitating him, with him as our King. And Father, give us confidence for the future. Thank you that our eternity is secure because of what Jesus did. Thank you that when we stand one day face to face with you, we will be safe and sure because of what Jesus did. Thank you that one day we'll be in eternity with you because of what Jesus did on the cross for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue in song now, so please stand as we sing Jerusalem.
Jerusalem, walking where
front because it's time for our kids' talk. Good morning. Good Friday. Well, hello. How are you guys going today? Who's had some hot cross buns already? Oh, yeah. Anyone had any chocolate already? Oh, you had some chocolate already? It's supposed to be on Sunday. That's right. You had chocolate earlier, that's right. All right, guys, this morning I want to start we got a video to watch about Easter, but I wanted to start by learning a chant. We're gonna try and memorize this little chant, and we'll see if we can say it over the next few weeks here at church. See if you can remember it on Sunday, and then after that, right? So I've got some actions and some words, right? So parents, you might need to help your littlest kids if they're not quite able to do it. But this is the way it goes, right? So we say, God sent Jesus, we're going to make a J on a hand, Jesus, to make peace with us. Right, so we're going to try and say that a few times to see if we can remember it. All right, can you guys say it along with me? Ready? God sent Jesus to make peace with us. All right, now we're going to say it three more times. And each time we're going to say it a little bit different to try and help us remember it, right? So we're going to say it really low. Can you talk in a low voice? Will, can I hear your low voice? Good job. All right, ready? God sent Jesus to make peace with us. If someone to say it really, 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 really high pitch. Do you think you can do high pitch? All right, ready? God sent Jesus to make peace with us. Oh, good job. Now we're going to do it really, really, really fast. Ready? One, two, three. God sent Jesus to make peace with us. Oh, good job. Okay, well, that's what Easter is really about. You know that? God sent Jesus to make peace with us. And what Jesus did at Easter by dying on the cross and rising again, that was how God made peace with us. And we have a little video that's going to tell us a little bit about what happened at Easter.
The story of Easter, Jesus' sacrifice. This is Jesus,
Hey-o!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like calming storms. The Jewish leaders and teachers did not like what Jesus was doing or how he claimed to be the Son of God. And so they made a plan to arrest him to get rid of him once and for all. Jesus was presented before the high council and they asked him if he was the Messiah, the Savior of the Jews. They asked him if he was claiming to be the Son of God. You say that I am. And the council was furious, and they shouted that Jesus was guilty, and he deserves to die. Once Jesus made it to the place where he would be crucified, called the Skull, the soldiers around him nailed him to the cross and waited for him to die. While Jesus was hanging on the cross, many people shouted to him, "If you really are the Son of God, save yourself from the cross." But Jesus knew he had to die to forgive his people for their sins. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land. 3 hours later, Jesus took his last breath and finally died. At that very moment, the curtain in the temple that separated the priests from God's holy place tore in two. A soldier watching the whole thing said, "This man truly was the Son of God." Then a righteous man named Joseph came and placed Jesus' body in a tomb. 3 days passed and it seemed that there was no hope. But very early on Sunday morning, the woman who cared for Jesus went to go visit his body and found that his tomb was empty and that he was no longer there. "Don't be afraid," said an angel. "He is not here. He is risen." At this, the woman remembered that Jesus had told them that he would rise again on the third day. And ran to go tell the disciples what they had seen and heard.
Huh? Hey-o!
Ah!
And then for the next 40 days, Jesus appeared to his disciples and many others and showed them that he was alive and well. He taught them that what he did was the only way that they could be forgiven and be with God forever. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life.
Well, there you go. That's what Easter is all about. Good Friday, we remember how Jesus died on the cross. And on Easter Sunday, we remember how he came back to life. We remember how Jesus died on the cross so that we could be forgiven and be with God forever. And on Easter Sunday, we remember that he rose as King forever. Well, so I just want to remind you, as you eat lots of chocolate and Easter eggs and hot cross buns over the next few days, I want you to remember that Easter is really about how God sent Jesus to make peace with us. Can you do it with me one more time? Ready? God sent Jesus to make peace with us. All right, very good. I'm going to pray and thank God for that. So can you put your hands together so you don't fidget and close your eyes and don't get distracted, and let's pray to God. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you sent Jesus to make peace with us. Thank you that Jesus died on the cross to forgive us so that we can live with you forever. Thank you that Jesus rose again as King of everything. Please help us to put our trust in him. Amen. All right, boys and girls, thanks for coming to the Kids Talk. You can head back to your parents now. If you'd like, there's some activity sheets at the back for those who would like to do that. And Ben's going to tell us what we're doing next. Thanks, Ben. Oh. Wait, we're doing a kids' song. Come back. Sorry. Oh, goodness gracious. All right, stand up. Everyone can stand up. We're going to sing a kids' song. It is good to know that Jesus died for each and every one of us, isn't it? So why don't you head on back to your seats, and Ben is going to tell us what we're doing next. Thanks, Ben.
Yes, we're taking up the offering next. This is something we do as a church family, so don't feel obligated to do that if you're visiting with us. The funds that we're going to take up, that we're going to collect today, is going to our distress fund just for caring for the community. So I'll ask the stewards to come forward. We'll take up the offering. Please stay seated, and then we'll stand to pray for the offering. Let's pray. Lord and Heavenly Father, we praise you for your generosity, that you were rich, yet for our sake you became poor, so that we, through your poverty, might become rich. And we praise you, O Lord. We ask you to accept our offerings and use them for the work of your gospel and the extension of your kingdom, both here in Townsville and in the world in general. We pray this in the glory for the glory of your name. Amen. Well, we're having a Bible reading now, so the Bible reading will be up there, and Damon will take over from here.
Thanks, Ben. Well, I'm not sure if I introduced myself earlier. I'm Damon. I'm one of the ministers here at St. Andrew's. We're going to be reading from Matthew chapter 27, from verses 11 to 54, which is, we're going to begin from verse 11. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things that they testify against you?" But he gave them no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And they said, "Why?" And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." And all the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters. And they gathered the whole battalion before him, and they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they spit on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. And when they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments among them by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there, and over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself if you are the Son of God. Come down from the cross." So also the chief priests and the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he so desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness all over the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, "This man is calling Elijah."
And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." And Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. When the centurion and those who were with him, keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, "Truly, this was the Son of God." This is the word of the Lord. Well, we're going to spend a few minutes looking at a part of this passage from the Bible this morning about Jesus' death. This is from the book of Matthew, which is one of the accounts of Jesus' life and death and resurrection. But as we begin our time together, I want to start by asking you a question. What are you frustrated with in your life? Or what are you frustrated about the world that we live in? What are you disappointed by or dissatisfied with? What do you just kind of yearn or wish was better? I was talking with a group of my friends during the week. There's four of us. We catch up and check in on each other every now and again, just to see how we're going, and it's refreshing. It's great to catch up with them. And it was really lovely, but it wasn't actually all perfect. One of the guys said that his sister-in-law had just been diagnosed with cancer. She's in her mid to late 30s, and she's now facing operations, chemo, and who knows what else. I kind of wish that that wasn't part of our catch-up. Not because I wish he hadn't told us, I'm really glad that he did, but because I wish it didn't happen. At times like that, I yearn for something better. I don't know about you, but as I look around the world, I often wish for something better than this world. Something better than this life and all of its brokenness and sadness and disease and problems. I read an article during the week that said that anger, stress, sadness, pain, and worry had increased globally by about 10% over the last 20 years. I'm not entirely sure how they figured that out, but it makes sense that many of us are left wanting something better, something more. Now, we have it pretty good here in Australia, but I wonder how the cost of living crisis has affected you and your family. My wife has recently broken and started buying the cheaper bread that she doesn't like as much. That's silly, but really, we've had to tighten our be more careful with our money. And we aren't even really struggling, not like some of the stories you hear of people that are really struggling to make ends meet with the rising cost of living. The reality is our world is broken. Our lives are not what we wish they were. And so how do we fix this broken world? Now, I actually think there's lots of solutions that are offered to us. Perhaps science and education will fix everything. But really, as technology has advanced, our world hasn't gotten less broken, has it? Natural disasters seem to be getting worse, not better, as we advance technologically. I don't think science or education is the answer, not the ultimate solution. Perhaps the right leaders are the right solution, the right political party. Perhaps now that we have the right mayor, our lives will all be better off. Or perhaps the right life guru, like Jordan Peterson or Andrew Tate. We turn to people like this because we see the problems with our lives. We want something better. But I think at the end of the day, they all ultimately leave us unsatisfied. That's why inevitably we end up changing governments, I think, because eventually we think, well, these guys can't fix it. Maybe the other guys will. You know, the Bible actually offers what we just read out here. The Bible offers a radically different solution to the problem of a broken world and our messy lives. The Bible's solution is what we're here to celebrate on this Good Friday. It's this man, Jesus of Nazareth, who died 2,000 years ago on a cross outside Jerusalem and was raised to life again. He's the key. His death here is the key to hope for a better life and a better world. So in our time together this morning, I'd love to show you how the Bible describes our situation and why Jesus is the key to something better. And the first thing I want to show you is the root of the problem of our broken world.
And it's our rejection of God. The root of the problem of our broken world is our rejection of God. See, the Bible actually begins by telling us, showing us what life was meant to be like, what the world was made to be. God makes the world, and then we read this. He says, "And God saw everything that he'd made, and behold, it was very good." Our world started very good. The picture painted at the start of the Bible is a world made for people so that they could look after it as they lived in harmony with God. And I think this is actually exactly why it feels so wrong when our friends get cancer. When cyclones destroy people's lives. When we find out that there's more slavery in the world now than there's ever been. Because that's not what life was meant to be like. And we see it start to unravel two chapters later in the Bible. By the third chapter, the people God put in the garden disobey his directions for how to live in his world. If you know the story, you'll know that a serpent, Satan, convinced them that they could be like God. And so they chose to do things their way instead of God's way. They listened to their own desires rather than listening to God's instructions. This is what the Bible calls sin, rejecting God and living our own way. But as soon as humanity turned away from God, the brokenness of the world becomes clear. Adam and Eve, the people that God put in the garden, they're ashamed even to be in front of each other. They become scared of God. Their relationship with one another and their relationship with God is all of a sudden messy. And the world becomes messy as well. You see, God comes to them after this happens, and we see the first moment of judgment in the Bible. I'm going to read out a section of this judgment from verse 17. There's more to this, but I'm just going to read out this section from verse 17. And to Adam, God said, "Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and you've eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. And by the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return." This is a moment of judgment. It's sober. This is the first moment of judgment in the Bible. And in this judgment, we see, just before the section I read out, that relationships are going to be messy. And we see that the world is not going to work the way it was supposed to work. Our lives are broken because we live our way instead of God's way. The world is broken because it's under God's judgment. And it's under God's judgment because we live our way instead of God's way. See, the Bible says, it argues, it's clear that the root cause of our broken world and our messy lives is sin, our rejection of God. Now, I saw a video a little while ago recently of some people trying to put together a flat pack deck chair, but they were trying to do it in a weird way. It was a sort of a competition. There were five teams and it was a bit of a race, but one person from each team was in a separate location with the instructions. And they had to relay the instructions via walkie-talkie to the rest of the team. So they had the manual, the rest of the team didn't know what to do, and they were sort of... Anyway, all the teams finished. It took them a long time, but a reasonable time to sort of get it done, except for one team. See, there was this one team where they didn't listen to the person with the instructions. The people on the team just thought, "We know better than that guy." They completely ignored and overruled the guy with the instruction book. It wasn't going to work out well. It actually took them hours longer than all of the other teams to finish. That's what we're doing when we reject God. We ignore and overrule the God who made the world. And it doesn't work. All it leads to is brokenness. You know, I think the brokenness of the world is meant to alert us to something. It's meant to alert us to the fact that something is not right. When we see cyclones and disease, when we see humans fighting and wars and hurting each other, when we see people enslaving each other people who are made in the image of God, I think we're meant to realize that something is not right here. And we're meant to yearn for something more, something better. And the whole rest of the Bible is about showing us just how broken the world is, just how helpless we are to fix it, and how God stepped in to fix it for us. In fact, God promised that right from the start. In the midst of that first moment of judgment, God hinted that someday he would fix it. This is from the same section I read out before, two verses earlier. God says, I'll put enmity between you, that's the snake, and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. This is God promising that someday someone would defeat Satan. Someone would defeat what he had done in leading people away from God. And that's what Good Friday is all about, right? Jesus dying to fix the root cause of our broken lives and our broken world. Jesus dying to save us from our sins. You know, when Jesus was on earth, he was asked by someone, John the Baptist, he was asked by someone if he was the one that God had sent. If he was the one that was going to fix the problem. And Jesus responded like this. Jesus answered them, go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. You see, Jesus knew that the world was broken. He spent his life fixing it. He healed the sick. He gave people their sight back, their hearing. He made it so that people who couldn't walk could walk. Now, this showed that Jesus was fully God and fully man, but it also gave us a taste of what life was meant to be like. It gave us a taste of something better. The life that Jesus has come to give us, to make possible for us. Something better than this world with all of its brokenness. But to fully and completely give us this better life, Jesus had to do more than just heal a few people. To fix the problem in an ultimate way, he had to do something more significant. And that's the good news at the end of that verse I just read out. A bigger plan to fix our broken world. And that good news was about how he would die and rise again for us. And we get now to the passage I read out earlier. I'm going to pick it up from verse 45, just as Jesus dies on the cross. Now from the sixth hour, there was darkness all over the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some bystanders hearing it said, this man is calling Elijah. One of them at once ran and took a sponge and filled it with sour wine and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But others said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. And Jesus cried out with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Here in this section, as Jesus dies, the first thing we're told about is that the world was shrouded in darkness. And the second thing we're told is that Jesus cried out, asking why God had forsaken him. Both of these point to the fact that this is a moment of judgment. Throughout the Bible, darkness is a sign of God's judgment. This is another moment of judgment in the Bible. But instead of judging us here, instead of judging the world, instead of judging humanity, God is judging Jesus. So what's going on? In his death, Jesus is dealing with the root cause of our broken lives, of our broken world, sin. Because as Jesus died on the cross, he takes the judgment that we deserve for our sin. This is a moment of judgment where Jesus offers himself up as a substitute for us. He takes the judgment that we deserve. He didn't deserve it, but he took it. And by taking it, he leaves us pardoned. No longer guilty. No longer under the judgment or the curse of God. Sin was the root cause, and Jesus' death dealt with the consequences of sin. It dealt with the root cause. Jesus' death restores our relationship with God and begins to allow us to repair our relationships with one another and gives us hope of a better world. So why is the world still messed up? Why are our lives still messy? If Jesus has dealt with the root cause, why isn't it perfect yet? Well, it's because we have the choice to accept Jesus' offer, Jesus' sacrifice for us, or to reject it. See, Jesus takes the sins of those who entrust themselves to him, those who put their faith in him. The Bible says that God is waiting for people to turn to him. See, Jesus has dealt with the root cause. And someday that means that we will go to a world that will be perfect. a better world, a better life that God, that Jesus has made possible by dealing with our sin for us. But that change is not just for the future. In a couple of weeks, we'll think about this a bit more. Jesus' death changes life for us here and now. As we wait, we're able to resist sin, to have a restored relationship with God. And we can begin to repair our relationships with one another. When we begin to live in light of this better world and better life that Jesus' death has made possible. But we do live waiting, because God is waiting for people to turn to Him. Before Jesus returns to remake this world, a new and perfect world, where all those who put their trust in Him will live in a better world with better lives. So let me encourage you this morning to look for something better than this world. Put your faith in Jesus. Be forgiven of your sins. Look forward to this new and better world, this new and better life. If you're struggling in this life, look around. If you look around and see the brokenness of this world, if you feel like there must be something better, then let me encourage you to find something better in Jesus. He died to deal with the root cause so that we might have a better life. Turn to Him and trust yourself to Him. Because in Him you'll find hope of something better. I'm going to pray as we close now. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank You on this Good Friday that Jesus died to deal with sin, to deal with our rejection of You, to deal with the way that we hurt one another, the way that we've broken the world around us because we have not listened to You and Your good instructions. Father, thank You that as He dies, He deals with our sin. He makes a way for us to be right with You, to be in right relationship with You by taking our punishment for us. Lord, please help us to put our trust in Him. Lord, help us as we experience the pain and difficulty of this life, as we look around and see the brokenness of our world. Please, Lord, may that stir us to look for something better and to know that that better can be found in Jesus. Please help us this day in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to respond to God's word now by singing "It Was Finished Upon That Cross." So please stand together as we sing our last song.
Well, thanks for joining us today for our Easter service, Good Friday service. Please join us on Sunday for our Easter services, 9 and 10:30. This is the end of our formal time together. Feel free to grab a hot cross bun as you leave. But before we finish, let's end with a benediction and the threefold Amen. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy in peace and believing, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen.